Come on, put your hands together if you're grateful in the house. If you know that he's worthy to be praised, come on, let's magnify him. Let's go. Oh, magnify the Lord. Let me hear you. For he is worthy to be praised. Sing with me. Oh, magnify the Lord. For he is worthy to be praised. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come on, bless it. Blessed be the rock. Let's go. Blessed be. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna. Blessed be the rock, yes. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Let's go. Oh, magnify the Lord. For he is worthy to be. Come on, church, open up your mouth. Oh, magnify the Lord. For he is. Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed be, blessed be. Come on, clap. Blessed be the rock of my soul. Hosanna, yeah. Come on, bless it. Blessed be the rock. Hey, blessed be the rock of my soul. Come on, let's sing it. Say, I will call. I will call upon the Lord. For he is worthy to be praised. I will call. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Come on, oh, magnify the Lord. For he is. I can't hear you, RKC. Come on, oh, magnify the Lord. Come on, let's clap. Clap, 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 clap. Come on. Come on, clap your hands. Oh, clap your hands. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock, 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 blessed be the rock of my salvation. Y'all ready? We ain't stop yet. Come on, clap your hands. Do it like the Baptist church, just like Granny them used to do it. They were so excited to be in the house. Anybody excited? Because you know you had some trials, some fight just to get here. But we're going to bless him. Come on, clap your hands. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. I love that rock. I'm standing on the rock. Rock of my salvation. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock, blessed be the rock, blessed be the rock, blessed be the rock.
Put your hands together for the rock of your salvation, which is Jesus Christ.
Christ.
Amen, amen. It's so good to see all of you here in the sanctuary this morning. All of you guys online. So good to see all of you. RKC Florida. Good to have you with us today. Yes, welcome to Relevant Kingdom Center right here on the island of Great Exuma in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Indeed, one of the most powerful places on the planet. If you've never been here, you need to make your way here. We're going to go right into our scripture reading for today. And our scripture reading is taken from Psalms 34 and 3. If you have your Bibles or find it on your smartphones, if not, we've made it available for you on the screen. And we can all read it together. It says, "Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together." Together. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your Holy Spirit and your power. We thank you for your grace, your mercies, and your love. We pray now as we go into our experience today, take full control. Let your presence engulf this place, break chains, mend hearts, bring healing to those that need it. Lord, we need you more than ever before. We thank you for your kindness and your mercies towards us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, put your hands together all across the building. Come on, put your hands together. We ready? I want to hear you give a little clap. Come on. Come on, shake yourself loose. Anybody know that he has a plan and he's turning around? Listen. You turn my into worship. You turn my pressure. You turn my mourning into dancing. Come on, you turn my weeping into worship. Turn my pressure into praise. Turn my mourning into dancing. Come on, you turn it around. You turn. You turn my into worship. You turn my all my pressure into praise. Turn my mourning into dancing. You turn it around. He turned it all around. You turned it around. He's turning. You turn my weeping, all my heart dies, that bad relationship, oh yes you did, turn my into dancing, I will bless you all, you turn it around, you turn it around, he's turned. God. Come on, let's do a little clap.
Not because we're good, Father, but because you're good. My hallelujah
belongs to you. Come on, let's sing it, church. My hallelujah belongs to you. God, we're so grateful. We're so grateful. Thank you. My hallelujah belongs to you, Jesus. You deserve it. Come on, stretch your hands out. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. Come on, let's lift up our voices and say, my hallelujah belongs to you. When I think about my life and I think about where you brought me from, oh God, if it had not been for your love for me, oh God, it belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you and only you, Jesus. It belongs to you. Oh, somebody tell them you deserve it. You deserve my worship. You deserve my time, yes. You deserve everything I've got. It belongs to you. Come on, somebody tell them, say all the glory. All the glory belongs to you. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
All the glory belongs to you.
God, we won't be foolish to forget and to know that without you, oh God, that all the glory, it belongs to you, God, that you will share your glory with no man. All the glory belongs. It belongs to you. Come on, somebody lift your voices and tell them you deserve it. My life is a testimony of your faithfulness and your goodness. How you wrap me in your arms and you kept me. Oh, somebody shout. Top of my lungs, all the honor, come on, all the praise. Tell them you deserve it. When I look back at what you've done for me, my God, without you, I could not make it, my God. This bag of dirt just wanna tell you, you deserve it, oh my God. Maker of all the universe, almighty God, you deserve it. Come on, church, shout hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. All the glory, all the honor, and all the praise you deserve. You deserve, you deserve it. Oh, you deserve the praise. All of the honor, Jesus. When everybody else turned their backs on me, you stick and you stay. You remain, never change, always the same. You're so faithful, so holy. You deserve it. You deserve it, my hallelujah, my hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. You deserve it, you deserve it, yes.
Lord, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercies. Thank you for the opportunity to be able to lift our voices, to praise your holy and perfect name. There is truly no God like you. And you deserve all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. And so today we say hallelujah to your name. God, we thank you. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you. We can't thank you enough for your holy presence in this place today. Yes, Lord, you deserve it. You deserve every praise and all the praise. And so we thank you now for this experience. We thank you right now for your presence that we feel in this place, today. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Put your hands together and give God a praise in the place today. Here in paradise, we call Exoma. It is such a beautiful place. I'm telling you, if you've never been to Exoma, Bahamas before, you really should make it a point in your life to do it at least once here at Relevant Kingdom Center in the Bahamas, because we, our church that was called to reach the lost at any cost, we exist to communicate the word of God in a real and a relevant way, to help make disciples, to develop leaders, and to change lives of people, starting right here in the Bahamas, now in Port Charlotte, Florida, in one church with two locations. And so if you ever find yourself anywhere near Port Charlotte or here in the Bahamas, we would love to have you. Is there anyone visiting for the first time, first, second time? Anyone visiting for the first or second? Hey, we have a visitor right at the back. Sir, so good to have you. Yeah, welcome, welcome. So good to have you. In the seat pocket in the front of you, you'll find a connection card. And on the connection card, you can just fill out the front and the back of it. And sometimes during the service, the First Touch team will receive it from you. We'd like to get to know you better. You're online. If this is your first time online, you know, just put in the comment. You know, if this is your first or second time, and let us know where you are visiting from, and we'd like to reach out and communicate with you. Now, if you've been with us for the past several weeks, you know that we've been going sermon series right now, Words to Live By. Yes. And how many of you guys have been enjoying the series? Okay, we got a few people who've been enjoying the series. It's been a great experience for me personally. And let me tell you, it's amazing what you can pull out of the Word of God. You know, and these words have been timely and they've been effective, you know, for our daily life, daily living. I don't know about you, but I can't wait to hear what God has in store for us today during this final closing of Words to Live By. And so when we've heard again from Sister Brad Nico, then after that we'll hear from our campus administrator, Mr. Angelique Robinson.
God is getting ready to shake his church one more time. And so if you could listen and you got an ear, you need to hear this word and you need to apply it and you need to live by it and you need to do it, because when he starts shaking, the only things that are going to remain are the things that are strong and rooted and grounded. Everything else is going to fall off. And can I just tell you, that gave me goosebumps, holy goosebumps this week, because I said, God, and all of us could see it's evident that there is a shaking going on right now. And I said, God, man, there's some people falling off that I never thought would have fallen off. There's some people and some things falling off that I never thought in my life would have fallen off, because we were so strong, it seemed like. We were so focused that we were running a good race. Who got in the way? But God said, Dury, there's a shaking happening. And because I'm shaking my church, only that thing that is stable, only the thing that is truly rooted is going to remain. Why? Because I'm going to make sure that only the essentials last. We're connected to not just another good idea. We're connected and we're a part of a kingdom that cannot be shaken. A kingdom that's unstoppable. A kingdom that's unquenchable. A kingdom that's unbreakable. A kingdom that's undeniable. A kingdom that's unbeatable. So don't stop working in the kingdom. Don't stop doing what I've called you to do in the kingdom. Don't walk away from the kingdom. Don't allow your past to call you back, that you stop moving forward in the kingdom. He said, stay a part of this thing because it's unbeatable. It's unshakable. Come on. It's unquenchable.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Just for a few minutes. minutes, I just want you to think about where you're coming from. I know sometimes we get so caught up on, everything that we want, everything that we do not have. But I just want you to just consider where you used to be, how it used to be, how he changed your life. And I want you to consider what his promises says, that he's able to keep you from falling, that he's able to present you before his glorious presence without fault, that God will rescue you. And so even if you're in the congregation, online, wherever you're at, God will meet you right where you are, right in that chair, right where you are, right in that place of hardness, that place, wherever it is that you think that seems so hard. But he is a deliverer. He's a mighty deliverer. Whatever the case may be, the thing that you think that seems so hard, it may be an addiction to pornography, it may be fornication, it may be lying, it may be some bitterness, some unforgiveness, it may be a hard, hard thing. But God said, if you will trust me, I will meet you right where you are. God is that kind of God. And so if you're not in the house today and you know that he has met you right where you are, that place that is disgusting, that thing that you don't want to talk about, those stuff that we cannot share with the church people, that dark place, God will meet you right where you are and bring light to that situation, that icky, that sticky place, that messed up place, that place that you don't want to tell anybody about. He will meet you right there. He is your rescue, and he's giving you that handout right now. Just meet him right where you are. Close your eyes and just begin to extend your heart and just know that he is in the room today. Extend your heart to him because he will rescue. He is my rescuer. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody grateful? Anybody grateful that God, like messed up, jacked up, tied up, messed up people like us? Thank you for the blood. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Your testimony, say,
let your spirit cry and say, oh.
Just for a couple more seconds, just pushing, just a couple more seconds. Let's just push in. I don't think you guys understand what the song is saying, so let me break it down for you. It says that we're not perfect. It says that we're gonna mess up, but we have a Savior. We have somebody that rescues us every time that we fall. It says that you have rescued my life. You have rescued my life. You have saved my life from destruction. You have saved me from my own sin. You have saved me from my own self. You have saved me from my own ways. God, there is nothing that I could have done to deserve a God like this, a Savior like this. But God, thank you for rescuing me. Can I get a praise of thanks all across the building? If you can just say, Lord, thank you. A simple thank you for rescuing me. I might not be where I was or where I supposed to be, but God, I'm not where I used to be. Thank you for rescuing me. Thank you for rescuing me, God. Thank you for seeing something in me still, God. Thank you, God, for wiping me down and washing me, God. Thank you for never leaving me. Thank you for never forsaking me. You see, this is building up back up some people that thought they would have been lost, that thought that they would have been too far from God. It's building you back up because he's reminding you that I'm here to rescue you. That I'm here to rescue you. You don't have to look at nothing else. You don't have to look at the circumstances around. But when you focus in on me, I will rescue you every time, daughter. I will rescue you every time, son. Because that's just what he does. Because he's just that good. He's a good God. And he'll rescue us every time online. He is a rescuer. All across the building, he is a rescuer. Let's give God some praise that he rescues his people, that he's a savior, that he is faithful and he is good. If we could all stand all across the building, I want to go straight into the main text for today. Just look to your neighbor and say, neighbor, he's a rescuer. Amen. Just give them a hug too. Just give them a hug and just affirm them and let them know that he will rescue you every time. So I don't know what you're worried about. I don't know why you're fretting. He will rescue you online. He will rescue you. He is a restorer. He is a redeemer. Amen. Hallelujah. So our main text today is taken from John 3, verses 27 through 30. And it reads, John answered and said, a man can receive nothing, someone say nothing, unless it has been given to him from heaven. Verse 28 says, you yourselves bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but I have been sent before him. He who has the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly. Someone say greatly. Because of the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is fulfilled. He must increase, but I must decrease. Someone say you got to decrease. Look to your neighbor and tell him you got to decrease. Father God, I just want to thank you, Lord, for your word. Lord, I thank you, God, that your word will saturate the hearts of your people, God, that it would renew their minds, God, that it would change their direction, Father God, that it would change the trajectory of their life. God, I thank you, God, that this word will mark us forever. Holy Spirit, we invite you into the room. Lord, let me now decrease. Holy Spirit, you increase. In Jesus' name I pray, amen and amen. And you may be seated in the house of the Lord on today. So we are concluding our series, Words to Live By. A show of hands, how many people actually have been doing the word and not just hearing it? So just a show of hands. All right, we have a few. Amen, y'all. Let's praise the Lord for the doers and not just the hearers. But for the hearers, y'all gonna catch them up. Amen. So do you know that there is power in your decrease? You see, in verse 30, it says, he must increase, but I must decrease. Seven simple words that hold so much weight. And in order for us to fully understand the weight of these words, we have to understand the context of the text. So let's read the word. Someone say, let's read the word. Look to your neighbor and say, let's read the word, because that's what we need. We need that. John 3 and 22, it says, after these things, Jesus and his disciples came into the land of Judea, and there he remained with them and baptized. Verse 23, it says, now John was also baptizing in Anon near Salim, because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized. Verse 24 says, for John had not yet been thrown into prison. So we can see here that Jesus was actively on the scene, right? Jesus was already on the scene. John the Baptist would have already baptized Jesus. And in the verse before then, we see that he was just giving the good news to Nicodemus. So somebody say he was doing the work. He was doing the work. He was getting to work. And now he said, all right, let's go baptize. And we doing the work of the Lord. And the scripture says that John was also baptizing persons. And this is where we see a little problem arise here in the scripture. John 3 verses 25 through 26 says, then there arose a dispute between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purification. And they came to John and said to him, Rabbi, he who was with you beyond the Jordan, to whom you have testified, behold, he is baptizing. He is baptizing. That's the tune that I think. He is baptizing. And all are coming to him. John, can you believe it? Because you're John the Baptist. But everybody's going to him to be baptized. So basically, John's disciples who were ride or die about John, they were ride or die about John's ministry. They saw the Messiah. They saw the Savior. They saw Jesus as Mr. Johnny come lately. Where you going, right? So, and I believe that they were trying to figure out, honestly, how are we doing the same work? John, you've been doing this before him, but people are now following him and not you. So they told John, you know, what's going on? What do we need to do? Like, do you not see what's going on? What do we need to do? And I believe that they thought that John would have, you know, maybe given them some solutions, some directives, like, all right, y'all, let's huddle. Because we church folk, so we know what the means be about in the church. Y'all, let's huddle together. How could we get people? What's the strategy? That's what I'm thinking, that they were waiting for John to do. Like, how can we get people over here, you know? Like, what's the strategy? What do we need to do? Do I need to go out and invite them and take some people from his crowd and bring them over here? They were waiting for John to give them some strategy on what we need to do about this, right? So we'll see how John responded in a second. But I want you to notice even that they didn't even call Jesus by his name. They referred to him as the one who was with you, the one whom about you testified, because they realized that his identity was related to the success that he was experiencing, and they didn't like that. As soon as people don't like something that going well for you, they don't even begin to refer to you as what you are. They just go around it. They tiptoe around the greatness that you are, because they understand that your identity is connected to who you are. Your success is connected to your identity, and that is who you are. So we can see here that they were self-focused and not Christ-focused at this moment. They were self-focused, not Christ-focused. So this tells us that John's disciples then had some type of heart issue. And we're going to discover what heart issue that was. But they had some type of heart issue. Do you have a heart issue? Do we have some heart issues going on? What is your response to someone who is also called to do a work? Because we've all been called to do something. And sometimes it may look similar, sometimes it may not look similar, but what is your posture when somebody comes alongside to do a work? What is your heart posture towards this? And John, like the leader he was, he responded to his disciples, and he had to get them together truthfully. He had to even remind them and carry them back to the basics, because as good leaders, when we see arguments begin to break out and when we see confusion starting to happen, we need to take everything back to the basics to understand why we're here, what's the mission, what's the vision, why are we here, so that we can sort out all of the other noise, right? So that is what good leaders do, and that is what John did here. John 3, verses 27 through 30, it says that John answered, and this is our main text. He said, a man can receive nothing, first thing you need to know, unless it has been given to him from heaven. You yourselves bear me witness that I said to you that I am not the Christ. So you shouldn't be shocked now that the Christ is here, right? But I have been sent, I never confused you, I told you what it was, but I have been sent before him. He who has the bride, and he gave them an analogy, he said, all right, y'all may not understand where I'm coming from, let me break it down a little bit more for you. He who has the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is fulfilled. And in verse 30, he gives us something that would mark us forever. He says, he must increase and I must decrease. See, John takes his disciples back to the basics of what his ministry is all about and reminds them about their ministry as well. See, he wasn't worried about Jesus, but he endorsed Jesus' ministry. He approved of Jesus' ministry. And he told them that it made his heart filled with joy. He was happy to see another brother doing work. He was happy to see the Savior at that doing a work. John's response, it showed his heart, right? When John said he must increase, but I must decrease. When we think about decreasing, honestly, it doesn't fall on our list of things that we pray for. Lord, decrease me. No, it's like, Lord, increase my territory, increase every area of my life. That doesn't fall on the list. Lord, we don't want to decrease in any area. We just want to be increased, right? So I just know that his disciples, when they heard these things coming out of his mouth, they were probably shocked. And some were even maybe disappointed, because they were like, wow, we lost sight of what the mission and what the vision really was all along. So how many of you know, like John, this should all be our prayer posture? Lord, I want you to increase as I decrease. And some of our hearts, if we're honest, is we be a little tainted because we have flesh and we're not perfect, right? So at the prayer, if we're not careful, it can easily turn into, he must increase. Like, I want you to increase, but Lord, I also want you to increase me a little bit as well. Just increase me too. While you increase, and let's increase together. You know, like, why can't we increase together? Because us decreasing is a part of picking up our cross and dying to ourselves. That's why we can't increase together. It requires sacrifice and it requires surrender and putting yourself completely to the side to have a heart that says, no, I don't want any of me. Lord, I want all of you. I want to decrease. And when you say this, you're saying that I want to be forgotten. It's a heavy thing to say. You're saying that I want to be forgotten. I don't want anybody to see me. I don't want anybody to even think of me before they see him, before they think about him, before they know him. I want him to increase. Is that anybody prayer today that you want him to increase in your life? Maybe a little quiet because we're like, I don't know about all that. But you're saying that I want him to be seen even if I'm not seen. Once he is seen, that's all that matters to me. A posture that says, I want to decrease. And if we're honest with ourselves, we oftentimes don't want people to recognize us just a little bit. Like, I know that God sees me, but you know, I want other people to see me sometimes too. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing to be recognized or want to be recognized or want to be appreciated. It's not a bad thing, but it can become detrimental if that's what you live for. It can become detrimental if you begin to be offended by it and you hold an offense in your heart. It can be detrimental if that's the only thing you're looking for. When God says you need to look to me to be exalted, you need to look to me, right? So that's the part that makes it detrimental. Some people live to be seen, do you? Some people thrive off of people's approval, do you? These are questions that we need to ask ourselves. Some people are even offended when they're not seen. Are you? Are you? And these are all ways that we are able to check our heart posture and to check our motives. And you see, we have to come to a place where we say, Lord, I don't want to live for people to see me, but I want to live for people to see you. Do I have a people that say, Lord, I don't want to live for people to see me, but Lord, I want to live a life that people can say, I only saw Jesus in her. I only saw God. When I met her, I met Jesus. When I met her, I met God. When I met her, I saw the fruits of the Spirit. I don't want people to see me as nice and peaceful. I want you to know that it's only because of God I have peace. It's only because of God I have joy. It's only because of God I have self-control. It's nothing out of my own flesh. It's nothing out of my own strength, but it's everything because of the God I focus on. It's not me. It's him. And this verse, like I said before, if you allow it, it will mark your life forever. It would change your life forever. You see, these seven simple words show the heart of John. And his heart, we could see, was one of a word called humility. Someone say humility. And what is humility? Humility is to disregard all concern. Someone say all. All concern. That's crazy. That's why it's a progression. Because to say you're literally regarding all concern, for we still got a little tinge of, you know, our hearts are still a little tinge of something. But to say that I want to disregard all concern for rank and privilege and to live one's life in service, to accept all and serve all. Someone say all. To accept who? All. And serve who? All. So someone who has humility, it means that they're not proud. And it means that they don't believe that they're better than anybody else. C.S. Lewis puts it like this, and I love this quote. It says, humility is not thinking less of yourself. It's thinking of yourself less. I'm going to say that again. Humility is not thinking less of yourself, but it's about thinking about yourself less. So that means that we're focused on other people. We're not focused on us. That doesn't mean that I'm trying to say, oh, forget about what, like, you know, what you think about yourself. Or no. Humility is about focusing on you less, right? James 4 and 10, we see it says, humble yourselves before the Lord. And who will exalt you? He will exalt you. When you have an understanding, you see something, it's different when you have an understanding and when you get a revelation that I don't need to bring glory to myself. I don't need to brag on myself. I don't need to exalt myself. The Lord will do it. You're telling me that the Lord Almighty, who has all authority and all power, will exalt me? And I want to brag on myself? Oh no. And I want to exalt my own self, and I want to bring glory to my own self and what I do. Oh, no. Because I know in time that God will exalt me. So if John had a heart of humility, the disciples that were agitated and threatened by Jesus had some sort of pride issue. Because the opposite of humility is pride. If you're not humble, then you're prideful. Someone say pride. Someone say pride. You see, pride is extreme love and focus on oneself, being proud. And pride, I can tell you now, it will really mess you up. Someone say, don't be prideful. It will really mess you up because it would have you thinking, this is what pride does. It will have you thinking one way, or have you thinking that you're one way, not knowing that you're the complete opposite. Y'all ever had a conversation with somebody and they're saying, oh, like they're literally exalting themselves. That's the first red flag, right? You're exalting, yes, I do that. Yes, I'm this. Yes, I'm this. And it's like, you're not seeing it? It's like, hold on. I'm not really seeing it. Pride causes some type of blockage between them and the reality of what's going on because they're absorbed with their self, right? So John's disciples, honestly, they probably thought that they were doing a marvelous thing. They thought that they were the best disciples. They were like, look, let's do something about this. Like in their own eyes, they thought that they were doing a good job. They were focused on themselves though. That was the root of it. They were focused on themselves. They were focused on their own ministry. They were focused on their own agenda, right? That they missed that what they were actually doing was detrimental to their own souls. Don't focus on your own agenda. Don't, if you're prideful, hear me good. It can be detrimental to your own soul. I mean, the Savior, the person who came to save them. So I'm telling you, pride will mess you up. Someone say, pride will mess you up. And church getting a little quiet. Someone say, pride will mess you up. Look to your neighbor and tell them, pride will mess you up. Pride would have you taking the glory that belongs to God and placing it on yourself. I'm going to say that again. Pride will have you taking the glory that belongs to God and have you placing it on yourself. But if you think so highly of yourself, you can't even see that you're exalting yourself. Do you see how pride works? You think so highly of yourself that you can't even see that you're exalting yourself. And the thing is, how many of you know that we weren't made for glory? We weren't made, we weren't designed for glory. We weren't designed to be exalted. We weren't designed to be praised. We weren't designed for the weight of God's glory, the glory that only belongs to him, the honor that only belongs to him. We weren't designed for it. And that's why pride, what does it do? It only leads us to destruction. Because when you put the weight of something that somebody can't handle, what would it do? It will destroy you. It will destroy you. Proverbs 16 and 18, because y'all don't believe me. It says, pride goes before what? Destruction. And a haughty spirit, a proud spirit before what? A fall. And John the Baptist, He was such a good shepherd because he made sure to carry his disciples back to the, and that is what good people and good friends around you would do. They wouldn't talk about the fact that you have a pride problem, but they will come to you and say, hey, you have a pride problem. But let's take things back to the basics because I don't want you to land up to destruction. I want to see you on the other side. So let's take you back to the basics and redirect you from destruction that would have been headed their way. And that's what John the Baptist did. He redirected them because he didn't want them to lead in the way of destruction and keep on going into that direction. Someone say, don't fall. So I just want to show y'all something real quick. I want you to think about this balloon. I have two balloons here in case one fails. But I want you to think about this balloon as your life, right? This balloon is our lives. This balloon is Brad Nika. This balloon is Charlene. This balloon is Brother Naaman, Brother Alfred, Sister Demi. We got this balloon. This balloon represents us, right? And if we choose, we have two choices, right? The narrow road and the wide road. Pride is unfortunately on the wide road. So if we choose to allow pride to creep in, right? And this is called the pride puffer. If we allow pride to creep in, and let's say, what are the attributes of pride? Wanting to serve your own agenda. You allow that to start creeping into your mind. You're like, no, I don't like this agenda. I want my own agenda. I want to serve my own agenda, right? And then somebody comes up to you and says, okay, hold on. I see where this is going. I can see that you're getting puffed up. I can see that you're getting a little proud. I need you to bring it back down. So God gives us grace because although we could get puffed up a little bit, although we could get into some pride a little bit, he still gives us opportunity after opportunity after opportunity after opportunity to let ourselves come down. And this is us decreasing and him increasing, right? We're safe here. We're secured here. We're safe here. We're secured here when we decrease. And we let him increase. But the thing is, what if we just continue to choose? Let's see what happens if we continue to choose the wide road, if we continue to choose pride, if we continue to get puffed up, right? So what is another attribute of pride? You always need to be right about something. So nobody could ever talk to you because you're always right. And you're never wrong. You're always right. What's another thing? No one else's opinion matters. So you're there, I don't care about your opinion, only mine matters. You're self-centered. I don't care about nobody else but me. I don't care about your vision, your mission. I care about my own agenda, right? You can't admit that you're wrong. That's another pride attribute. So we keep on pumping up ourselves. You won't ask for help because you're too prideful, and you keep on going. When you keep on getting puffed up, and this happens, do you see how many opportunities we had to deflate ourselves, though? Did you see how long our line of grace was until we end up into destruction, until pride carries us into destruction? Do you see how many? Let's see how much more chances we get. We even broke it trying to. So basically, that's what happens when you get too big or you get too puffed up. You ruin your own self. You end up into destruction. When things get too big, it ends up being ruined. Balloons pop when you puff them up with air too much. When you put the weight on them that was never supposed, when you put the weight of glory on your own self, that is what happens. You lead yourself into destruction. Don't be like that balloon. Don't allow pride to lead you to destruction. Don't allow, because you know what? Even that interruption just now shows you a fall. Right? And a fall means that, because it says a proud spirit comes before a fall. So a fall means that, okay, I can put it back on. Right, and I could begin pumping again, or I could deflate myself. We have endless opportunities that God gives us to say, okay, you could choose humility here, or are you going to choose pride here again? I'm going to give you another chance. I'm going to allow you to choose humility, or are you going to choose pride? Which one will you choose? Someone say, which one will you choose? Which one will you choose? Because you see, pride separates us from God. Why does it separate us? Because it destroys us. And it keeps us falling. It destroys us and it keeps us falling. But humility, it brings us closer to Him. Because if the disciples were to say, okay, clearly John's time is over, which is why John the Baptist probably had to be beheaded, because it seems like his disciples was a little wild. They was a little too loyal, right? So it's all in God's will, right? So even in God's grace for that, they were able to, I'm sure, see that this is the Savior. They were able to see in their humility that we can get closer to Him when we follow Him and not our own way. So how are we able to stay in the lane of humility? The first thing that we can see from John the Baptist is you have to know your assignment. Know your assignment. So the broad spectrum of every Christian's assignment would to bring Christ glory. And that was John's ultimate mission, to bring God glory. When I was reading this text, I was thinking to myself, well, why were John's disciples upset if they were all doing the same work? Why were they in an uproar if everybody all doing the same thing that was interesting to me? And then it clicked that is where the pride showed up, right? And it made them, what pride does to people, it made them delusional. Because we're both serving one goal. It's honestly, the people say these days, it's diabolical to me. For me to be upset with you if we're both on the same team, doing the same, because at the end of the day, we may be working in different aspects, but we're all doing the same thing, serving a winning team. So who cares if you have more than me? Once we're reaching the same goal and once I have the people that God has called me to, who cares, right? And this is the culture that we need in the church. And this is the culture that we need in communities and in businesses. If we all have this mindset that I don't care what you're doing, I'm going to endorse you, I'm going to support you, because we're all on a winning team. Someone say, we're all on one team. I hope. Amen. We're all on one team. This is the culture that we need. And I don't care about what you got going on or how many people over there. Once we're all doing it to the honor and the glory of God. Because the thing is, pride, what it also wants to do, it wants to divide us. But humility, what does it do? Humility saying, okay, feel some type, but I'm gonna pick up my cross. Like I could choose pride today. But today I'm picking up my cross and I'm choosing humility and I'm going to say sorry and I'm going to repent and I'm going to do all the things, because that is what's going to unite you. Y'all ever had somebody say, put your pride to the side? Why would I need to put my pride to the side? Because when humility is front and center, we get to be connected together. We get to grow together. Someone say, put that pride to the side. Put that pride to the side. And in the Bible it says, a kingdom divided cannot stand. Right? So we can learn from the life of John. From inception, we can even see that he never was envious or even questioned, well, why do I have to be the forerunner? Can you imagine dedicating your life to somebody to be greater than you? That is what he was saying yes to. He was saying yes to dying to himself, to somebody that who would be greater than him. And that is what we say yes to every single day. Lord, I want to do it my way, but I'm going to say yes to you. I'll decrease, Lord, you increase. Why? Because he understood his role. He understood his assignment. He understood the lane. He understood. He didn't only understand it, but he understood the importance of it. When you understand why you're important, when you understand your role, when you begin to have a revelation, things begin to change. See, he focused on Jesus. So he couldn't feel threatened on somebody that he was paving the way for. he couldn't feel threatened by somebody he was paving the way for. Because all glory and all honor belongs to him. You see, even when he responded, we see the analogy he gave us was the best man and the bridegroom. And the best man, they feel joy when the bride and the bridegroom is being celebrated. That is how we should feel about our brothers and our sisters moving up, right? We should be able to feel joy when we see them fulfilling the thing that God has called them to do. He must increase, but I must decrease. Number two, we need to understand that it's not my work, it's God's work. It's not my work, but it's God's work. Someone say it's God's work. See, John, in his response to the disciples, he reminded them that it wasn't his work, but it was God's work all along. Like, I'm sorry if I ever confuse y'all. I swear I told y'all that I'm not the Christ. But he reminded them that it was never about him, but it was all about Jesus. John said, firstly, like I said, if so many people are following Jesus, what does it mean? It must mean that it came from God. Secondly, he reminded them that he was not the Christ. Like I said before, he was not the Savior. He was not the Messiah, which is why we have to always remember that we're just men. Nothing else. I'm just flesh. We're all just flesh. We're not perfect. Doesn't matter what earthly position we have, we are not perfect. We all fall short of the glory of God. So as soon as you put somebody on a pedestal, take them down. Because they could fall at any given time. I can fall at any given time. You can fall at any given time. So remind whoever's following you, it's me. I know I'm not perfect. No, I mess up. Don't look for me to come through perfect. I am a mess just as much as you are a mess. I have as much going on as much as you have going on. We all experience things together. We all do. He didn't want people to think that he was more important than he truly was. He also reminded them that he was sent before Christ to push people to Christ, not away from him. And he expressed that because of this, he experienced joy. What will happen to us when we begin to focus on Christ and we begin to focus on his people and his kingdom? We begin to experience joy when we see other people working and doing their work. We experience joy, like, keep on going, I see you. And that's where God pricks other people's heart to let them know and to affirm you, like, hey, you're doing such a good job, right? So humility happens when we know that this isn't our work, but it's God's work. Nothing that you have is yours. It's by the grace of God that we are even gifted with the talents that we have, with the time that we have, and with the work that we have now. We've been gifted a work for a reason. We have been gifted a work for a reason. I need you to get that. We've been gifted a work for a reason. And no matter where you are, no matter what role you play, you have to ensure and know that it's a gift. And number two, that everybody around you know it's not me, it's God. So as soon as people stop, don't pump me up. Decrease me, Lord. That's when you need to pray. Even when you start to feel like, oh yeah, wow, I do a good job. Baby, pump it down. Pump it down. Number three, and this is the last one, decrease daily. Someone say decrease daily. See, when we become Christians, we exchange our ways for God's ways. And it's a, someone say progression. It's a progression of decreasing. And what does decreasing mean? Dying to yourself and to our old self and becoming more like Christ as he increases in our thoughts and in our words and in our actions. You see, Jesus will become greater and greater in every aspect of our life as our old nature becomes less and less. You see, it's a process. Someone say it's a process. And sometimes, but you see how many opportunities that we have. Endless. So make sure that you don't come to the end of yourself and meet yourself with destruction. Allow the old self to continue to pump down, because sometimes we regress instead of progress. But the thing is, we have the opportunity and we have the grace and we have the mercy every single day to let a little air out, to bring down ourselves a little bit more, right? John the Baptist is a great example. How many of you think that was a great example of his humility? It's a great example. You see, he didn't do the work for selfish motivations or to get attention or to get power or to feel important or to get people to follow him. It was all about getting people to Jesus. So no matter what work you do, no matter what field you're in, your ultimate goal should be in this. How can I get people to see Jesus? How can I get people to experience him a little bit more? How can I get people to who they have called, who he has called them to be a little bit more through what I do, whether it be mundane, whether it be here at church? No matter where you go, these principles apply. So let's examine our hearts and question our whys, right? Sometimes we need to go back to the basics and we need to ask ourselves, okay, hold on, wait. Why did I start this thing in the first place? For us to get clarity. Why did I begin this thing in the first place? Why does God have me doing this work in the first place? Sometimes that's what we need to ask ourselves so that we can gain clarity on our next steps and how to serve well in the season that we're in. And we need to examine it often to ensure that our heart is filled with humility and never pride. We must have the attitude that we must decrease and God must increase. You see, if we put the emphasis on his increasing, our decreasing will fall into place by default. So what if we spend more time with him in his word? And you guys can stand. What if we spend more time with him in his word? We'll decrease, right? Because when we spend more time with him, we have less time for our own thoughts and our own logics. What if we spend more time talking to him in prayer? We'll decrease because we have less time listening to our own thoughts and our own worries and talking to other people, right? What if we spend more time serving his people? We'll decrease because we spend less time serving ourselves. What if we spend more time in his house? We'll decrease. Less time for worshiping other things in our life. So the bottom line of all of this today, if you don't remember anything else, remember that this work, your life, the work that he's given you, whether it be in the church, whether it be in the home, whether it be on your job, whether it be in your personal life, it's all about Jesus. So decrease daily so that you can see an increase of him in your life. How about our prayer be, Lord, decrease me and you increase. And I believe that if we pray that prayer, that we'd never have to ask him to increase anything in our lives again. Because when we seek him first, the kingdom of God and his righteousness, all, do you see how the word connects together? All these things are added on to you. So Father God, I just want to thank you, Lord, for your word today. Lord, thank you, God, that we are a people that come to you, God, repenting, God, of any piece of pride that is in our hearts, God. We ask that you would rid our hearts of the pride right now, God, and that every person under the sound of my voice, God, got a revelation today of the areas that we all need to be humble in, God, that we all can practice humility in, God. We ask today, God, that as you increase in our lives, God, we say right now, God, that we surrender to you and we decrease. If there's any person under the sound of my voice that has never said yes to Jesus, or maybe the flame has kind of gone down, or you want to say yes to Jesus for the first time today, this is your opportunity for you to raise your hands online. You can indicate and somebody will pray for you. I see that hand. Amen. Amen. This is your time to reconnect with God. And say, Lord, I don't want it to be about me anymore. I want my life to serve a greater purpose. I want it to be about you. And we don't allow you to pray alone here. So everybody under the sound of my voice, let's all pray together. Father God, I just want to say that I love you. And I'm sorry. And I repent of not knowing that it was all about you in the first place. But God, today, I surrender my heart. I surrender my mind. I surrender my entire being over to you. I declare you as my Lord and my Savior. And God, I'm not perfect, but please help me to progress in this walk of faith. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen and amen. Let's give God some praise in the place on today. Amen. So you may be seated in the house of the Lord. We are going to go straight into the time of giving. But if that word touched your life, let's just give God some praise. Amen. I pray that that seed is planted into your life. And we are all in this together. Someone say, we're all in this together. Y'all don't know the song? Amen. We're all in this together. We are all in this together. So we are getting ready to go into a time of giving. So I just want to welcome you to open up your hearts and prepare your gifts. Here at Relevant Kingdom Center, we say that you don't give to a church, but you give through a church, right? The Bible says that he wants us to give with what kind of heart? A cheerful, he loves a cheerful giver, all right? So, Father God, I want to thank you, Lord, for the gifts that are in the room. God, there is so much more where this came from because we know that you are our provider. I ask that you would bless every hand that gives